Muito bem, vamos passar à próxima sessão. A próxima sessão é, o orador vai ser o Grant Sinclair, que é sobrinho de Sir Clive. O Grant Sinclair tem 49 anos, é filho de Ian Sinclair e sobrinho de Sir Clive Sinclair, e é também ele um inventor. O Grant aprendeu e formou-se com o pai, que foi designer industrial responsável por desenhar muitos dos produtos iniciais da Sinclair, incluindo o amplificador Neotérico, que é dos mais bonitos que eu já vi até hoje, ou algumas das calculadoras, ainda hoje falávamos da Executive, foi a primeira calculadora de bolso feita pela Sinclair. O Grant colaborou no stand da Sinclair Research em diversos eventos, os eventos na altura muito conceituados Personal Computer World, entre 81 e 84, e trabalhou para a Sinclair Research em 86. O Grant desenvolveu um dos primeiros jogos que foi utilizado em eventos públicos de apresentação dos ZX Spectrum, onde teve algum sucesso, mas nunca foi lançado comercialmente. Também colaborou no desenvolvimento de um jogo educacional, uma versão interativa do jogo da Forca, o Hangman, que foi testado num centro escolar pioneiro para pessoas disléxicas. O Grant acompanha o trabalho do museu desde 2020 e tem colaborado pontualmente connosco. A lona gigante que temos no museu com o triciclo do C5 foi doada pelo Grant e foi usada num programa da BBC, onde ele estava a apresentar também um triciclo elétrico que, estou certo, nos vai falar na sua sessão. Há muito que vínhamos a planear a sua vinda a Portugal, que finalmente aconteceu, e portanto eu vou agora mudar para inglês. Grant, thank you so much. Welcome to Portugal. Finally we're here. So if you can join me on the stage.
Okay. Hello. Hello, everybody. So I'd like to talk a bit about my uncle Clive, some of the stories I'm going to be putting in my book that's coming out hopefully this year. Thank you for inviting me. So yeah, obviously Clive is a serial inventor, but my father also is an inventor, and he was an industrial designer for Clive in the early days, and also some products later on. So. It's also led to me doing some inventions of my own, which I launched a few years back, and continue to launch new products. So this is a very old photograph of Clive. He used to like collecting little miniature, he was obsessed by miniature products, miniature items as a child, so he would go to a show in London called the Ideal Home Show, and collected small micro matchboxes and like small mints, anything that was miniature he was obsessed by. But he also loved thin products, so I remember he gave my dad a thin cigarette case, which was quite unusual at the time. And even when he was a kid at school, he was an entrepreneur, so even when he was about 10 years old, he had a business where he would repaint kids' toy cars, so he would he had a pot of paint and he would dip the toy cars into the pot of paint and hang them up to dry, and he would charge people for the service. When he was about 18, he showcased his first invention when he was actually a journalist working for a Practical Wireless magazine, an electronics magazine, and he showcased this is in 1958, his matchbox size radio, which got a lot of excitement because nobody had done anything so small. But then in around 1962 and 64, he started doing electronics mail order kits. So the X10 was a very unusual amplifier because it allowed you to build your own amplifier. So DJs, for instance, and musicians would buy these because they're powerful enough to have your own like disco PA system. And around about the same time, a bit later, 66, Chris Curry of Acorn Computers, also one of the early founders of ARM, he worked for Clive. And one of the first products, he actually taught Alan Sugar of Amstrad how to build a hi-fi made out of one of these amplifiers. So now Alan Sugar from Amstrad, later on from Amstrad, would turn up at the Sinclair HQ on a Friday in a white van. He would buy up all the reject amplifiers he would fix and repair them and sell them on a market stall. So this was obviously before he made his millions and billions. Very, very early on, he was a fan of Sinclair. Now, this is a picture of my mother. So she was about 18 at the time, demonstrating one of the early radios that Clive was showcasing at a trade show in London. And around about this time, my father started doing the industrial design. So the previous product wasn't as good looking, but my dad styled the product and made it into a premium product, which got a lot of interest. My father did the graphics and not just the industrial design, but the packaging and the graphics. And my mum was the model and used in the publicity. Part of the reason Clive could get the price of these little radios so low cost is because he found out a way of buying reject transistors and testing them. So he would buy them for next to nothing, almost zero, buy them at very low cost and repair them. And he found that the transistors were just about good enough to use in a minute in his radio. So he was able to achieve a very low price point. This product was in the Saint, which had Roger Moore showcasing it. Another story is Clive Sinclair used to also do commissions for other companies. So not only commercial products, but Clive used to develop like bugs, so bugging equipment, surveillance, little miniature bug he developed for another company. Well, one of the stories Clive loved to tell, he said he was once walking along the street in New York and he saw someone selling these tiny remote control cars. What looked like tiny remote control cars, and they were about this big. And he bought one of the packs of these, and it turned out to be just actually tiny micro moldings that were stuck on top of ants. So these little micro control cars were being driven all around the place, but they're actually just ants with a fake body stuck on top. Now, what really got Clive known was the first small TV, which was in '66. Again, my dad did the styling for the product. And this was the first pocket TV, and nobody had seen anything like it. And this was on the front cover of most newspapers, not just UK, but also globally. It got his name, got him really well known around this time. And then later, my father, or Clive, invented this new sort of high-end amplifier. And my dad did the styling again. And this product was in Clockwork Orange, the film. In fact, Zhao has just acquired one of these in his collection, apparently. When this came out, people were so surprised by how small it was and the unique styling that I remember them saying that Bang & Olufsen, or Chris Curry, who was working for Clive, said that Bang & Olufsen came on the Sinclair stand to congratulate Sinclair on the achievement. And the name Neoteric came from an episode of The Avengers, which was a cult TV, 60s TV show. Again, not just hi-fi, but not just amplifiers, but speakers. Again, this is a very unusual circular speaker design from 1968. And recently, so in 2019, I noticed Bang & Olufsen did a very similar design to the Sinclair speaker from 40, 50 years ago. This record deck turntable, again, my dad designed for Clive, was developed in a space of about 6 weeks for a trade show to get some excitement going at the show, which is an example of really very unusual, fast R&D, really, because normally a turntable would take years to develop, but Clive said it has to be ready in time for the show, and they got it ready. So very ultra-fast R&D. This was a trade show design of modular exhibition stand that my father designed. The story behind this exhibition, it was unfortunately not very nice because a lot of the samples got stolen before the show. So then what really made Clive millions and millions was the first pocket calculator, which is this design is in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and he had 70% world market share at this time. It was, people just couldn't believe how the calculator is so slimline, which is achievable by some very clever circuitry and use of hearing aid batteries. Also, some very clever use of very thinner construction, lower component count. Clive used to always try and say the product has got to be as small as a matchbox or a packet of cigarettes, but this product was really wafer thin, like a phone of today, or it's even thinner than most phones of today. More calculators. Then in 1974, Clive wanted to do a watch, and he approached my father to do the design concept. In fact, Clive turned down, so this is the design my father did. Clive turned it down because it was too premium, whereas Clive wanted a much lower cost variation. So Clive used his only in-house designer, John Pemberton, which came up with this product, which is hugely successful, but was a disaster because of some production issues, some manufacturing issues at first, a chip shortage, but also there's an issue where if you went near the product with static, it would reset the product. So lost a lot of money, and one of the companies was lost because of this product, which was a very upsetting for everybody at the time. But Clive would often gamble everything on the next product, so his next product would have to be a winner to... He would gamble everything on it, so he'd take out the biggest adverts, and he would just really go for the marketing side of stuff. Again, this was sold as a kit, but it had some very unusual features. It had a flex circuit, flex PCB, and sort of stuff you have in smartwatches of today. Very, very ahead of its time. This was a very early calculator watch. Now, around this time, sales were going very badly because of the disaster of the watch, and the turnover was very bad. And so, well, one day this big white box arrived with the Sinclair brand printed on it, and in each one of the in the white box was many other white boxes with the Sinclair brand on, and then each one of these boxes was 20 boxes, all just little white boxes with the Sinclair brand on. And they're actually Sinclair branded cigarettes that were given as a present to Clive who by the PR company that worked for him at the time. In fact, Clive had just stopped smoking at that time, so Chris Curry smoked the whole lot, which nearly killed him. Then, in about 77, Clive did a low cost computer, the first one being the Mark MK14, which was a bit very similar to a Raspberry Pi of today in lots of ways, but obviously 35 years earlier. This product was a fraction of the cost of Apple's rival kit product. And then in 1980, the ZX80. Well, when I got very early ZX80, and I was 8 years old, so I didn't know what to do with it. But luckily, my family were friendly with Stephen Hawking, who obviously a very, very well-known author. And I took the product around to his house. I took the computer around to his house, and his son did this amazing program on it, this animation, which I always remember being in color. In fact, it was obviously in black and white. But that was the first time I saw something amazing being used on a computer. This is actually a games console my father designed for another company in Hong Kong. Clive was approached by a company to do a games console. In fact, Clive turned him down, but sent my father along to Hong Kong to talk to them, and my dad got a job of doing a games console, so my dad did a very unusual futuristic design. The problem being that my dad used the letter 9 on the product, which was, he thought it just looked cool, but in fact, 9 is bad luck in China. So you always research your market before launching a new product, obviously. Around this time, my dad started trying to come up with his own inventions, and this is a product called JetSkate that would pull you along on skates or skis, and the idea being it would fold up on and go on your back so you could avoid having to queue in the ski lift for the ski lift. So you pulls you up the mountain, fold it up, put it on your back, and then ski down. This is me testing it. So I was about 9 at this time or younger. And I was wearing size 10 ski boots on this with these grass skis. Then Clive did the first computer to sell under $100, which was made by Timex. Now, this was so successful that when they got back to the offices in King's Parade after the trade show, there were so many checks, so many orders were sent, being posted, they couldn't get through the office, into the office, because the post box was jammed, had jammed the door shut. There were that many checks and orders, it was unbelievable. And I went to the trade show, I think it's the Personal Computer World Show, with Chris Curry and my dad. And we were watching the Acorn stand and we were watching the Sinclair stand. And my father at the end said to Chris Curry, "What do you think everyone will be buying next year?" Chris Curry looked at him and said, "Probably ZX82s," which of course was a Spectrum. Yeah, around this time also, later on in the 90s actually, I said to Clive, "Have you ever met Steve Jobs?" And Clive said, yeah, I met him in around 81 and sitting on the floor of a party. And I said, "Yeah, what did he say? And he said, "How did you manage to make computers so low cost?" And then about a year or so later, I said to Clive, we were having a drink in London, and I said to Clive, "Have you ever met Bill Gates?" And he said, yeah. And he said, I met him. I was sitting on the floor of a party. And I said, "Oh, come on, Clive, you've told me exactly the same story for the different person." He said, "No, they were both sitting on the same floor or the same party." So my family were very, very friendly with Acorn, and Chris Curry would send me the computers, the rival computers, the BBC Micro. So I was very lucky to get to use all, you know, many different computers, and I was allowed on the Acorn stand and also the Sinclair stand. So we were all very good friends, even though there's a lot of rivalry. Really, the tension only occurred really right at the very end of when the problems occurred, when everybody had a computer, basically. Everybody who could afford a computer had one. So we're all good friends. But the Spectrum really won the war. When I got the very first Spectrum, because I wrote a letter to Clive saying, "Dear Clive, can I get a computer? Can I get the Spectrum when it comes out?" He sent me one of the very first ones, but it didn't even have a demo tape with it. And it didn't have a printed box. It was like an issue one Spectrum. And so I had it at a school fete, and we all these people were crowding around it, and we had no games for it because no games came out. So I had to get these kids to quickly write a fortune teller story, and that was really successful. We made loads and loads of money, and then later my school, I got one for my school, and there was a teacher there. This was around the same time who came up with an interactive learning game, which kids loved. So it was very early use of an interactive game in schools, and people went crazy. Around about this time, Clive got about 42% of the home computer market, which is quite something, because Acorn only had about 10%. So in Cambridge, in the Sinclair lab, I was allowed to go in, and I saw this amazing, one of the most exciting things I ever saw was a Spectrum with a prototype, with a joystick plugged into the Spectrum, and it had a prototype breadboard. And this was must have been the prototype for the Interface 2, and I tried this. It was just quite something, using an Atari joystick with a Spectrum. It was just really cool to be allowed to, you know, the privilege of being allowed in the lab. But I was obviously sworn to secrecy, but when I went home, my father said, "I've just been asked by Cyan to design a joystick interface for Cyan." In fact, it never came out, but my dad did a design for Cyan, which was a rival, and I wasn't allowed to talk about it. I wasn't even allowed to tell my dad that Sinclair were working the same thing. So it was all lots of people working on very similar things, but a lot of secrecy going on. With the success of the Spectrum, Clive went out and bought a private jet, because part of the reason was it took a long time and a lot of money for all the Sinclair staff, well, not all the Sinclair staff, but some of the Sinclair staff to fly, get all the way to Timex in Dundee, and then back again. And it was too much to get back in one day. So Clive figured out, well, if we get a private jet, It can be done. And someone told me that they had a mini bar in the jet, and so at the end of the day, you know, a handful of them would get very drunk on the plane. Whereas some of the others had to just do number crunching and it's very much a sort of madman work ethic. A lot of fun, a lot of parties, it was a really fun time to be around. Both Chris Curry and Clive both had really good parties. And when Clive got the jet, Chris Curry went out and bought a whole village, which he got when he was 35. By the time he was 40, he had lost the whole lot. So everyone really, when the home computer market buckled really in around 85, 86, everybody was in the same boat. Lots of stock, not much sales, but it was a fun time, and Clive and Chris used to have a lot of fun, throw some really good parties. Yeah, the QL was obviously the business machine that. Which was, I think the part of the problem was it was quite high priced. I mean, it was £400, but a lot of the Sinclair fans wanted a low cost gaming device. A lot of people have told me that if Sinclair had gone with a proper floppy disk drive, it would have been a success because it had such good software. And I personally thought it was a great machine, had great software, and it won the chess championships, where the computers played against each other. And obviously Linux, the inventor of Linux, had a Sinclair QL, and apparently wrote a lot of stuff on it. Obviously, most people know about flat screen TVs. Clive pioneered it. I think I saw the first prototype in about 79, but it took him a while to actually get it into production. In fact, Sony beat Clive by a few months, got theirs out, but Sony's was three times the price. Whereas Clive had some very, very clever engineering where he had most of the electronics on one chip. Some things that people don't know is Clive also had a color tube in development, which would have been amazing. But also, I heard that the QL was going to have a built-in screen originally. Yeah, when I first saw the first electric bike I ever saw was in Cambridge in the 70s, so like 1979. They had a prototype rally chopper with an electric motor on. And I had a go on it in the loft at the Sinclair office, which was amazing. So Clive was working on electric vehicles from very early on, and then by 1981, I actually had the C5 prototype in my house, and I used to drive that around, which was pretty incredible. Clive also talked about developing a flying plane, a one-person flying plane that was going to be completely automatic. And my father used to say, well, Clive can go up in it first. But I think a lot of people say how they ridicule the C5, but it was amazing to have what a lot of people forget is that he basically developed a car that was sold for £400. And he was the first person to mass produce an electric vehicle. So this was a plant at Hoover. But when Clive launched the C5, he took out a £3 million advertising campaign, which is huge. I mean, that was probably about equivalent to about £40 million now. But when it all, Clive told me a story that when it all went bad, the sales weren't big enough, Hoover stopped making. Clive was negotiating with Hoover's lawyers in his flat to settle because Clive personally guaranteed, he made a mistake of personally guaranteeing the investment for the production plant. And Clive said that they were working all through the night trying to negotiate with Hoover's lawyers and it wasn't going anywhere. But Clive had this very, very experienced lawyer and he got his briefcase, leather briefcase or satchel, and threw it across the table and said, I've had enough. And Hoover, the story goes that Hoover then settled, and Clive got a pretty good deal with that. So 86, Clive sold out to Amstrad. I was actually working for Clive at the time. Oh, it was publicised that that Clive only got 5 million, but in fact Clive got a lot more. He got 9 million. So it's 5 million for the rights to the Spectrum, I think, and another 4 million for the name, the Sinclair name, which was an amazingly good deal. I mean, that was, you know, getting on for 20 million cash advance. So Clive really got a great deal out of that, and Clive said they had a great meal before the deal. And but about 2 years later, Clive went into direct competition again with Amstrad, because Dixon's, the big UK electrical retailer, wanted to buy satellite dish system for when Astra was going into space, the Astra satellite. Clive knew about this and knew whoever got the contract would make millions out of a satellite dish. And again, my dad did the Starling, but my dad came up with the idea of having a flat, putting the stalk inside the satellite. And whereas Amstrad went the conventional route of having the stalk on the outside. And the trouble being that our system, although it started off wafer thin, it started getting fatter and fatter as the engineers tried to stuff the antenna on the inside. And eventually, by the time we got ours to work, Amstrad already got theirs out, which is unfortunate for Sinclair, but Amstrad really did really well with it, and they made, I would think, getting on for billions, at least a billion out of satellite systems, because they sold out to Sky later on. So Amstrad and Sinclair rivalry dated back way into the 70s, and then kicked off in the mid-80s, and then carried on in the later 80s. And again, Clive did the, Jao was talking about the mobile phone that Clive pioneered. He did this because he had seen this technology used in Hong Kong, and all the kids, he came back from Hong Kong saying, all the kids have got these mobile phones. It's great, we're going to make a fortune out of it. But in fact, this system relied on being by a point, like a Wi-Fi point today. And they only put the points in the UK in certain territories, I think Manchester or Birmingham. It just wasn't adopted, and the sales weren't big enough. But Clive would keep trying, and he would pump millions into developing these products. And this phone is still, you know, lighter than a mobile phone of today, which is pretty staggering, really. And then the Zike, which came out in '92. Again, a lot of the technology in this product is still only being adopted by e-bike manufacturers today, like, you know, integrated battery inside the frame and motor integrated inside the frame. And when Clive launched this, he launched on Tomorrow's World, and he actually, it got stuck. So the throttle got jammed on while they were filming. And so Clive was just going round and round and round, out of control. And my cousin had to go up with some pliers and snip the cables. The sales of the Zike were actually pretty good for an e-bike. But Clive wasn't interested. Clive was only interested in success if he would see success if everybody had one. So he'd only sell a few thousand, wasn't of interest to him. Now, my father, I thought I'd talk a bit more about his products, because he did Starling. He designed chess computer, gaming computers for other brands like Cytec, and he did over 100 for Cytec, mainly chess computers, but also other gaming computers. Most of the market leading, these were under the Kasparov brand. And so a lot of people don't know, but that my father did over 100 designs of computers. So it was very much design-led family, lots and lots of computers. My father actually did some concept designs for Acorn at one stage as well. We're all, you know, all very good friends. Then my father did his own product in '94, which was a thin torch made out of cardboard, a thin flashlight torch. And I personally did the sales and marketing for this product. We sold millions and millions, and it was, it kept us going for about 10 years. From having nothing, we ran out of money when we launched this product. We're, you know, on the verge of bankruptcy, but we made a fortune out of this one product from one TV appearance. And most blue chip companies worldwide bought this. I customized this product. We sold this product as a custom item, and we were making thousands and thousands in the UK. Clive did the folding bike in 2006. Again, it's one of the lightest bikes in the world. Lots of amazing technology. Most of the, I think all the parts were designed from scratch, which is a very Clive thing. You know, he'd say, oh, it's got to have a wheel of a certain size. Clive would say, why? And he would challenge every little detail. And I once went around his flat and I saw these little wheels about this big. I said, what are they for? He said, the Mark II bike. As a follow-up to my father's torch, he did the Eon, which was the first flashlight to have white LEDs. So we had worldwide patents on white LEDs to be used in a lighting device, which cost a lot of money to register. And in fact, we did very well with our product, but we never kept the patents up. But of course, white LEDs are in everything now, which is a real shame we never kept these up. My father also did a credit card-sized knife, which was a hit product. Very, very successful. And finally, well, not finally, but almost finally, I developed my own console a couple of years ago, showed it on TV, and I have the very first samples here, shipping samples to present to Judge Dow later in a minute. One last product, my own invention. I did my own electric vehicle concept, which was fully enclosed. And we launched this on BBC TV. We showed off the first prototype in 2017 on BBC News. And they told me when they were going to film the next day, they said they got 10 million people seeing it globally on television and on BBC News. And we literally, the battery didn't even arrive until the day before. We had never tested it. And not only that, we didn't test it until the real day of filming because we had no idea whether it would break or work. Or, in fact, it went really well and things started happening for us after that date. We got contacted from people all over the world, really excited and wanted to be involved. And that's where I am. Thank you very much.
The Poco.
The museum.
Okay.
Okay,
let me open and show. No, you don't have to leave. Wait, which is a few minutes. We have a few minutes more. Let me just open and share with everyone. So the Poco that Grant referred. So it's another piece to go into the museum, naturally. And so thank you, Grant, so much.
Okay.
So I had a couple of questions there, but I'm sure that there will be a couple of questions also. I'll just make a comment, and I'm joking. Don't get upset with me. I'm not happier than I was before, because you're giving me a lot of trouble. You're showing a lot of prototypes and things, so now I have things to look for. I saw the risk calculator and I told to my wife, oh, I don't have that one. I'm looking for it. It doesn't have the zero and has a tiny button. And I said, come on. So joking,
Well, you need the IRS. I'll bring an IRS
time. Yeah. And we, the city hall, the mayor is no longer here, but we agreed already today that we are going to try it in the park.
It'd be fantastic.
In the bicycle path. So let's just open for the audience. I'm sure there are questions. I think it was very interesting. Thank you so much. Okay. Gave an overview of all the Sinclair family inventions. And there are questions already there. So,
Hi.
Hi.
Hello. Thank you very much for your presentation. There was a rumor. You'll tell me if it's true or not, but your family, so you're partial, that Sir Clive Sinclair was not a very easy person to work with.
Is it a rumor?
he could be tough at times to work with. He is very, very focused and would challenge every detail. So say you're working, one of his engineers, Mark Sanders, in fact, who is a very well-known bike designer, bike engineer, really, worked for Clive, and I said, and he told me that Clive challenged every detail. So he would say, well, I don't think we should go smaller than a certain size for the wheel, for instance. And Clive would say, why? And well, Mark Sanders might say, well, if you go below this size, it won't go over potholes very well. Clive would say, well, I don't care. I just want people to be able to go from the house to the train station. Or, you know, Clive had challenged every detail. So, you know, somebody said, well, the frame has got to be, you can't, well, I remember an exact example, the small wheels I was telling you about. The wheel manufacturer said you couldn't put the weight of a human on the wheels, on these small wheels, the people who made the wheel. And Clive said, well, I'll decide that, thanks. And Clive did his own tests, and actually they could take a lot more weight than a human. So he would challenge every decision, really, often. Not always, sometimes it let certain aspects of the engineers get on with it, but the whole thing about Clive is he would do things his own way, and part of the reason why he was so good, you know, somebody would say, oh, you need this chip and you need this chip, Clive would say, no, why can't we do it with this one chip? Why can't we do the whole thing on one chip? And really, that's how he got the price of the TV, for instance, to be a third the price of Sony, was because he redesigned everything. And he said, I want it all on one chip, mainly on one chip. And if you look at the Sony rival, which they tore apart in the launch of the flat screen TV, of Clive's flat screen TV, they had it all spewed out all over the place with all the electronics. Sony had, you know, dozens of chips in it. Which showed how good engineer Sinclair was and really how good Clive was, because he could do it all on one chip. And that was always his goal. And one of his most proud achievements, really, was getting the ZX81 down to four chips.
Yep.
Because that allowed him to undercut everybody in the world. Nobody got near him. And even the people who make the chip couldn't believe how he did it, you know? Nobody could believe it. But I'll tell you an interesting fact. Part of the reason he got the Spectrum to be so low cost, and it's a trick he learned in his hi-fi years, he would buy reject memory. I think he bought reject memory and used several loads in the Spectrum, so he'd get the memory half price.
Yep.
Little tricks like that Clive knew to be one step ahead. So the answer, short answer, is he could be tough, very tough to deal with at times, especially if things don't go well. But as long as things are going well, he generally, from my experience, he's great to work for. And, you know, obviously things don't always go well in business. And especially if you take as big risks as Clive did, everything, he would gamble everything on the next product. And obviously if you gamble everything and you don't have any reserve, things can go a bit crazy when things go wrong. And that's when you get friction. And yeah, so it could be tough. People found it tough working for Clive, but a lot of people... he would treat his staff often very well, but I'm sure you'll get other people's opinions on this. This is just my opinion. And
can I just make a comment, because I think it's very interesting. So what Grant was saying about the memory chips and also the transistors. So Clive would buy the rejects, and I think they were called the MAT or something like that, the transistors. Yeah. And so he would test them, reclassify them. But what I find more clever is not that. Is that he would write books with schematics using those transistors to create the demand. So he has at least two books, which are basically schematics using his own transistors. And I think that's fascinating.
Jim Westwood, his engineer, did say that Clive did one book, which was something like 20 projects.
21 projects or something like that.
And Jim Westwood said that he didn't think that Clive had tested any of them. They were all theory circuits. Because you know, they didn't really work. I mean, it was a book of theory products, basically. Yeah. But people like Jim Westwood would get these things to work, or he would he would find a way of re-engineering it to get it to work. So really, Clive was laying down the seed of a foundation of an idea, really, in those books. But yeah, very good point.
Okay. Okay, guys, one question. We have 1 minute. So one final question from João Oliveira.
Hello. Thank you for your talk and time here today. Today we have the Spectrum. We can relate. I'm 46 years old, but I wonder how it was for Clive. Hi-fis, electronic kits, magazines that you could do. I'm curious about the link between Clive and your father. Did they go to the same school? They are obviously very creative.
Yeah.
In the pedagogical level, how did it happen? You know,
Well, interesting question. I mean, there lies quite a story because my grandfather would also take big risks. So he was an engineer, and he took one. He had a business where he imports small tractors. The first sit-on tractors, and the distributor ripped him off basically. So, cut a long story short, he ended up going bankrupt, not just once but twice. So they lost, the family lost everything. The bailiffs came around and took everything. They had nothing, and the children were sent off to live with an aunt. But also were sent around lots of different boarding schools, sometimes together. So Clive and Ian would sometimes be at boarding schools together. But a lot of the time, I remember my father used to run away from school a lot, and so he'd get expelled. From school, so he would move school a lot, and so sometimes they're together. And Clive is a bit older, so he's about 3 years older. But my father said that Clive always had lots of really good, really interesting friends at school. But yeah, so some schools together. They're brothers. They're very competitive. Very competitive. But my family and my grandfather especially, always encouraged. Inventing. They would sit around the family table, and he would say, "What have you invented today?" And they'd have to come up with ideas. Oh, you know, shit.
pressure.
Yeah. They'd have these discussions and these arguments, and it was a bit of a crazy household and a bit of a crazy way of life. And I think that's part of what drove Clive to be successful. Is because of the ups and downs, he sort of wanted to have some sort of stability, but probably taking those sort of level of risks was in his blood, as it is for my father. Very, very, they're risk takers, you know, and that's in the DNA, really. So thank you for your question.
Okay, so I think now we're done. Thank you, Grant.